Welcome, everyone. My name is Phil Eagleburger. My wife, Jane Tracy, and I are Cleveland Park small business owners, as well as Cleveland Park residents. We are thrilled that you joined us tonight for the kickoff of the Fall Speaker Series. Our aim is to bring people together to hear from talented neighbors from our Woodley and Cleveland Park community on relevant and interesting topics. The series is brought to you by four organizations: the Cleveland Park Main Street, the Woodley Park Main Street. Those help our local, often small businesses succeed. The Cleveland Park and Woodley Park Village, whose mission is to serve seniors in our community through volunteer support. And, of course, the DC Public Library. The library has designated Tuesday Talks as a Know Your Neighbor program, celebrating what makes DC neighborhoods unique and helps us to connect neighbors and helps build community pride. Now, tonight, you can submit comments and questions at any point during tonight's talks. Just state your name, and we will get to as many as possible after the presentation concludes. Tonight's topic is celebrating the pioneering work of William Christenberry. I'm honored to be introducing our speakers this evening, but I will be very brief. Since it is Sandy's and George's stage, I have had the fortunate pleasure of being the next door neighbor here on Macomb Street in Cleveland Park of the Christenberry family for the last 27 years. Bill Christenberry was an internationally renowned artist who passed away in 2016 at the age of 80. After a long struggle with Alzheimer's disease. But as is often the case in such an artist's successful career, there was a silent partner of sorts. And in this family, that pillar of support was Bill's wife of 50 years, Sandra Dean Christenberry. George Hemphill, as a private gallery curator and or owner in the DC area for close to 40 years, but that could be longer. I'm not sure I'm right about that, but he can correct me. He is one of the most important figures in and proponents of the Washington art scene. And as such, George had the opportunity of working with Bill Christenberry over the years on over 20 different exhibitions. He first met Bill when George was a college student in 1974, so their history goes way back. There are much more fascinating details in both Sandy's and George's careers and connections to Bill, and I would suggest strongly that you check out the bios for them on the website. And the website is districtbridges.org/Tuesday Talks, and it'll take you right to the bios. But instead of me droning on and reading those, I think that such is better related by them personally. And so without further ado, I introduce to you Ms. Sandy Christenberry and Mr. George Hemphill.
Start with a little history of how Bill and I arrived on Macomb Street. We got to DC in September of 68, and we lived on Mintwood Place in Adams Morgan for several years. At the same time, Bill had rented a studio. It was an old ballet studio at 2625 Connecticut Avenue Northwest in Woodley Park. So I also was conceived in Washington, D.C., because my parents met and married here during the war. They both worked for the FBI. So I feel in a way I've sort of come full circle, but we moved to Macomb Street in 1972. It was April. I had seen this house for rent before and really loved it. Primarily, we wanted to be here because of the school districts. It came available for rent again. And this time I said to Bill, we are moving to this house. And we did. That was 2747. And we lived there for several years until 2739 became available for rent, at which point we took this house because it had such a beautiful yard and more space. So that's how we came to be here. We built the studio in 1984, the end of 84, finished in March of 85. The architect was Joseph Nook, who sadly has passed away, but it's been a wonderful space. Bill has created a tremendous amount of work there, as well as on his yearly trips, our yearly trips down south. So that's how we got to be in the neighborhood. And we've loved it. We've loved all of our neighbors, for the most part. And just living here has been wonderful. We are glad the kids went to John Eaton, Alice Steele, and Wilson. We were DC public school parents for, I figured out, it was about 23 years. And that's sort of how we arrived in the neighborhood. Bill also, of course, as you know, taught at the Corcoran for 4 years. He was dearly beloved teacher, had hundreds of students, and some of whom took his courses year after year after year. I called them the old groupies and the new groupies because there were two different sets of people in. I don't know, George, you want to add a little bit about how Bill's work got started in galleries here?
Sure. I mean, my engagement with Bill's work professionally, other than what was mentioned earlier about meeting him as a college student, began in 1984, about the time the studio was built there on Macomb Street. And I was working at Middendorf Gallery. And I had personally been trying to find my way in the context of a very competitive art world and a very competitive gallery. And I had an earlier background just from my family, in photography and in the arts, but in particular, photography was a huge pastime in my family. In fact, our family pictures are often my grandfather taking a picture of his oldest son, one of my uncles, to the middle uncle, to my father taking a picture, to another cousin taking a picture. There was sort of these looping photographic experiences. But anyway, I began to work concentrate on photography with both the Middendorf Gallery began to represent William Eggleston and William Christenberry. And as being Southern and having background in photography, it was a natural for me and inspirational because not only did I admire both photographers, I knew on a personal level the territory, the content of the photographs. So, and it was a particularly productive time for Bill because Bill had always made different kinds of artwork, but he really expanded into wall constructions, into the more abstract sculptures, into large scale and small scale photographs. And it was sort of a whole universe of things were being built. And the studio, as Sandy described, it was kind of a vortex of activity. There were regular museum buses that would stop and docents would come see things and we would bring in curators there and then individual collectors, and then just people who were interested. Bill was enormously generous with his time, almost to my irritation, because usually my job was to make sure things sold, and I was a little more impatient with the looky-loos rather than the people who were collecting work. And that's my failing, not really. So I learned a lot from Bill. But one thing I would point out about the studio and the experiences that I had there. And then the routine I got into with Bill was is that it made me realize not only was he a great teacher, a great visual artist who made sculpture, paintings, works on paper, photographs, he was a consummate performer. And I'll let a little secret out now that Bill's passed away was is that I don't know whether he wrote his spiel down in the studio, but it got to be something that I knew the parts of. And there would be occasions where on a Sunday morning, we had a studio visit, which being a Sunday would be a special studio visit. It would be a serious collector usually. And Bill would be a little ragged, a little tired. And usually it followed a game, an Alabama football game. And Bill would get to a point where he was making his spiel, his presentation, and he would forget a line. And I would often fill the line in because I had seen the performance enough that I knew what the next line in the presentation about the artwork was. But I think one of the things to understand about Bill's work is every piece was a piece of a universe that he was building and constantly expanding on. And there was always a little bit of you're only getting not only just a piece of the artist, you're only getting a piece of this world. And I think we can present some images later or anytime we're ready to do that. And we can demonstrate that sort of pieces of a different view of a world.
Yes, George, you're right about Bill considered all of the work that he did, the photographs, the drawings, the sculptures, the paintings, the tableau as part of a whole. Mm-hmm. And it was... At one point, it was sort of distressing to him that the emphasis on his work was being placed on the photographs, you know, because he thought, well, there's so much more to it. But eventually, I think people began to realize that, although I think we, you know, it needs to be pointed out more. By
I think it was a feature of the times, too. Because I concentrated on photography when I was at Middendorf Gallery, and it was the rise of a very robust and aggressive audience to purchase photographs. It was sort of the dawning of the adulthood of the baby boom generation, and photography was of second nature. And it's great that was, you might say, the foot in the door for greater attention being paid to Bill's work, but ultimately, what we made an effort to do and what occurred with the audience was is that they were interested in having that whole experience. They didn't want one piece of the pie. They wanted the whole pie. And particularly, you know, I would say as we ventured into the 90s and when I opened my own gallery, almost always the shows were a representation of all the mediums. I don't think we did, other than maybe a small show every now and then, about a particular theme, that we did any show that wasn't sculpture or works on paper,
yeah,
or sculpture photographs or works on paper photographs, that sort of thing, to try to give people a whole idea of it. But I think we also knew that the 80s had concentrated so much on paying attention to Bill's photographs that we had to make an extra effort for the other mediums.
Right. And because Bill was such a prolific artist, there are hundreds of drawings, and they're so beautiful too. But I what?
That's what you're supposed to say.
Well, you know, Bill's way of working, he was very intense in the studio. He was very organized, and you know, he had his routine. The days that he would work in the studio when he wasn't teaching, this is when he was teaching, he would have his breakfast and he would go out to the studio and he would work. Then he would come in and have lunch, and he'd go back out to the studio and he'd work some more. Then he'd come back in and have a drink before dinner, have dinner, and then go back out to the studio and sit for a while and sort of look at what he had done. And he was always, he had so many ideas, you know, that he, once he'd get on a roll, he would work on one thing for quite a while, but he always came back to drawing. That was his love, was drawing. So that's sort of like a thread through the whole body of his work. You know?
Yeah. You find that with different artists that they do that. I think there's this, sometimes there's this sort of romantic illusion that an artist sits around pondering clouds and has this moment where lightning strikes and they create masterpieces. And the more often than not, the truth is that artists are much like factory workers. They punch a clock, you know, and they work and they work and they work. And I know with Bill, with the works on paper, particularly the large works on paper that he did through the 90s and the early 2000s, there was an editing process. Mm-hmm. So there was a lot of production, and then they're the ones that get weeded out as not as good as others, or ones that get reworked. So, but those were also, there was a sort of, I don't know, the end of the day automatic writing. I always felt like they had a quality to them that was concentrated.
Yeah.
They were 25-year-old scotch. They were like right at the point, you know, there was intensity in those pieces.
He called those drawings high-risk drawings because mm-hmm. he had a large drawing table and the paper would be flat on the table, and he would stand over it with whatever instrument he was using to draw with. It could have been a brush, or it could have been a chopstick or a piece of wood. And he would do these drawings quite rapidly. And on those, he said, well, you know, it's either hit or miss. You know, mm-hmm. Those he did not rework. He either got it or he didn't that first time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, let me see. Well, the studio has, since Bill's death, has been in a state of flux, I guess. And we've had a lot of work come back that is in need of being stored somewhere besides the studio. Bill would be horrified to see it as it is today, but we've got plans to take care of that situation and then get the studio in shape to where people can come and visit again. I always enjoyed that, and I think, you know, people seem to really enjoy it. Of course, Bill was such a great storyteller that he would have folks mesmerized to the point where they wouldn't want to leave sometimes. So I'd have to, you know, sort of nudge them along. But
people love that experience. They love the experience of it's sort of like going backstage. to see how the thing is done and the setting in which artists make work. And we were talking earlier before we started the broadcast about how it's fascinating how we look into the news interviews, and every news person has a library behind them,
and right.
They're reading and what they've got up there, and you know, they've got some strange lamp or they got bad artwork or whatever. We're looking behind the scenes, and you know, that's very similar to what the studio visit is to go and see this place in which artists work, because it still is, regardless of my talking about punching the clock, it's still like a kind of witch's cauldron. It's a place where magic occurs, or the concentration is different than other people experience in their other careers, which might have on the face of it, a more practical aspect to it. So, but it was always great about Bill's studio was that because he had such a great sense of order, the studio itself kind of told a story when you went there.
Well,
I remember when I was working on the wall constructions for the show. We did a wall constructions that he had piles of nails. Now, there were piles. They were on the floor, but they were corralled. And they were one size nail and then another size nail. And then there was the sandpaper to scrape the surface off. And then there was the kind of paint. And it was like, it reminded me of when I watched my wife cook. There's as much time ordering the ingredients as there is like actually baking the cake. So it made for a nice experience to see that part of the studio. But the other part about the studio too is that, and I think people have seen this, we can show a picture later, is that the often you go to an artist studio and it is dominated by examples of the artist work, painting after painting after painting. And, you know, I've been to studios all over the country and almost all of them are, the artist's work in process, finished, stored, leaning here and there, stacks of paper, flat files, that sort of thing. And Bill's studio is dominated by the things that he collected that were sort of talismans to the content of his work. So he went to a studio, it was already a kind of gallery experience. You know, we have the studio wall with all the signage collected on it and then various little objects and the way Bill collected the number three and had all kinds of three-dimensional cutout threes. And so it was always interesting to see the studio because in a way Bill was giving people an inkling of the raw materials that he was working with, but it wasn't paint you were looking at. It was graphic ideas and signage and then the wording and signage, that sort of thing.
Right.
So the studio experience was different in that sense than it would be with other artists. So.
Right. Well, someone has asked if we could talk about Bill's legacy today. Well, part of his legacy is in the number of students that he taught. So many of them are still our working artists today. And of course, he's also, I think, left a legacy in terms of other photographers who have followed in his steps, Walker Evans's steps, and Eggleston's, and because Bill Eggleston were in that, I guess, the first group of color photographers who mm-hmm. took photography as a serious art form. And he never thought of himself as being like some well-known famous guy. Those of you who knew him realize that he was a very, sort of humble. Well, he could be not humble sometimes, but soft-spoken, gentle, polite, Southern gentleman. That's the way a lot of people described him. And he loved the South. He loved where he was from. He loved his family. And I think one way that his work appeals to people is that it strikes places in their hearts that is meaningful to them. And we had so many people who would come by after an exhibition, and many of them with tears in their eyes saying, that photograph reminded me so much of my childhood, or I remember seeing those when I went to visit my grandparents, or I grew up in a place like that. And it meant something to them, seriously. I think Bill was a very great artist and just, well, his body of work is so large, it's almost like you were an historian as well as an artist about a whole part of the country. that's changing, as it should. But he was very much interested in depicting all those things that he loved, as well as the part of the South that he did not love, which of course was the Klan. Let me see here. We have.
I think one of the things that when we talk about legacy with Bill is something that I'll encounter with collectors and other photographers. So they'll make a photograph, and then they'll show it to me, and they'll say, "Well, I can't use this photograph." I'll say, "Why?" And they say, "Because, well, it's a Bill Christenberry photograph." And when you find that artists in particular and photographers know that when they shoot a particular subject matter and it veers into or shows the influence of another photographer and they have to avoid it, you know that the photographer has staked a claim to a certain kind of approach and content. And you know that becomes the kind of language about photography or image taking or the meaning of it. The other legacy I think that we're building on and will begin to grasp is that we had artists in the early part of the 20th century, which were typically called regionalists, and they depicted an area of the country and they depicted a set of values about that country and some of that parts of the country. And often that was a kind of, often it could be a very idealized or very stilted view of the country. As great as those artists were, like Grant Wood or Thomas Hart Benton, they had a very stylized American tale that they were telling. And the Mill's the last half of the 20th century and the very beginning of the 21st century. And he is an artist who so loved the place that he was coming from that he wanted to save the things about that area that were noble, but he never blanched or diluted the sense of decay that the South had that he grew up in. And you know, you could make a story about the South with the new industrial South, the sort of, here's the BMW plant and here's the science lab at the University of Alabama and all those things that are reclaiming the South economically. But for the most part, through Bill's childhood and my childhood as well, I'm clearly several generations younger, was that you were overwhelmed always by decaying ideas, decaying structures, decaying racial relationships, decaying sense of a decorum in a society which was wasteful and silly. And the South had a great deal of nobility to it, which is still present in Bill's work, but it never shies away this haunting idea about decay. And, you know, that's difficult in our age, particularly the way the media works today, not to see things in black and white and to portray the story with all its vicissitudes and all its sadness as well as all its triumph. So if you look at Bill's sculptures, for example, what you see is an overwhelming sense of the nobility of the structure, yet the structure in a certain sense is in decay. There is something bursting forward with positiveness. At the same time, it does not try to diminish the negative quality that was present.
Yeah. So George?
Yes.
I think now might be a time to show some of the slides.
Sure.
Okay.
Let's see.
Marissa. Okay.
Yeah. I can narrate this if you want. Go through and talk about what we have here.
Sure.
Okay. This is a brownie photograph. It's a color brownie photograph of Sprott Church, and the earliest photographs made by Bill were made actually for subject matter for paintings. Whether they were color or black and white, they weren't intended to be finished artworks in themselves. They became that because there was a general realization, Walter Hobbs and Walker Evans, in the absolute elegance and beauty of these photographs. But this print's 2.5 by 5 inches. It's a tiny thing made with a Brownie camera, which is a camera, a Bakelite camera made in the late 40s and early 50s. So we can go on. This is house and car, and this is a Brownie photograph as well. You can actually see Bill's shadow in the foreground there. And then the next one.
Might be a little bit of Friedlander.
Yeah, a little Friedlander there. So, and that's a Brownie photograph as well. So this, you can see the, like the sense of respect for this object, but also it's got some flat tires. It's an old car. Who knows whether it drives or not? And it looks like it was painted with a brush and a can of enamel paint. Next picture. This is a 20 by 24. Bill began to work with a large format, a Deerdor field camera, which is a beautiful mahogany and metal apparatus on a tripod. It produces an 8 by 10 negative, and these photographs could be printed at 20 by 24 inches and larger. And so you got a great deal more detail out of them. And then the photographs began to really attract attention from the collecting audience with the 20 by 24s. So Bill would return to locations and photograph the same subject matter over and over again. In fact, there's sequences of photographs on particular subject matters that start 1961 and go all the way up into the 90s. So you get 25, 26 photographs that chronicle the life of a building. I think what's noteworthy in this photograph, folks might not be able to see it on their screens tonight, but one of the changes here, and often this occurred in Bill's photographs, creeps into it in a very small way, as well as the larger way of the decay of the building. This is now called Martin Luther King Boulevard.
Yes, and this building was called the Barbecue Inn. And it's Bill took pictures of this space for years until it burned to the ground and there was nothing but a foundation, a slab.
Not the easiest photograph to sell, I might say, is the slab that the building used to be on. But I like the surreal sense of negative space. Next image. This is Red Building and Forest. And Bill photographed this again year after year after year. But I think what's noteworthy here is this is a polling station. And after the 1964 Civil Rights Act, Alabama was forced to put polling stations in locations according to the density of population. So there would be ones available. Alabama, not yet agreeing to the efforts of the 64 Voting Act, would put the some of the polling stations in very remote areas, even though they balanced according to the population. So this happens to be out in a pine forest.
It's a Talladega National Forest.
Yeah. So here in the background, you see 20 photographs. And those photographs are taken over in more 20, 30 years of visiting a location called Green Warehouse. And then often Bill would make a sculpture that represented the actual location that he had photographed. I think it's noteworthy that Bill was adamant that these not be called replicas of the building. And in fact, true to that idea that they weren't replicas, he never took measurements of the original building as an architect might building a model or a replica of a building. He more or less did it intuitively on the basis of how he had experienced those structures. Bill also made more abstract sculptures. This is a Southern Monument, and they often incorporated found objects in them. This is a signage that's been hand-painted signage that rusted and weathered, and then it's been cut into parts and wrapped around a cube. And then in the base there, you'll see that there's pebbles and red soil or red earth, which is something he mined, let's say, from Alabama and bring to Washington and then incorporated into the sculptures. And then he also made pieces called dream buildings. And this was from a dream that he had where he if you read some of Bill's writing, he actually describes the dream that he had and then felt like if he could dream this image, he could make these things, and he could make variations on them. And he like another great Southern artist, Jasper Johns, who, whenever asked about why he painted the American flag, he said he had a dream of the American flag and painted it. So I've always thought that Jasper Johns was blowing smoke, but Bill really did have the dream.
Yeah, he did.
Is a dream building ensemble. So this is, I think, 16 different sculptures.
11. Yeah.
And then Sandy was mentioning earlier how the thing that runs through all of Bill's work is his passion for drawing. And we in Bill's biography, I always like to point out that his educational period in the late 50s and early 60s was in the aftermath of abstract expressionism. And he had a great teacher who was part of that movement, Melville Price. As we were talking about Bill's work being in this universe of things, it was able to incorporate not just one style or one medium. It was just not photography that was a kind of reportage of architecture and landscape in the South. It was that, and then it was representational sculptures of those things, and then it was abstracted pieces. And so much like de Kooning, who worked off the human figure as the thing he developed an abstract language out of, Bill worked off this idea of trees. And so these works on paper, as Sandy described, were produced in a kind of rapid fire kind of sessions. This piece is actually, the paper is painted green, and then the tree-like form is executed on top of it. And it's done with a very viscous black ink. So you could drip it or draw with it or drag it. So that Bill used various tools to do this with. Sometimes I'd come in the studio and he'd have 50 pencils taped together in one thing, and he'd draw with all 50 pencils at one time. So, and then Bill worked in different studios. For example, with his color photographs, Bill didn't print the color photographs. He worked with several labs in town. He worked with the dye transfer lab that was in Chicago, one in Houston, and one in New York. But he also worked with the Handprint Workshop International, which is out in Alexandria, Virginia. And they specialize in that studio in non-toxic print mediums. So they use water-based inks, but because they tried to develop as much, much versatility in the way ink works, and then also making it so that artists can interact with different layers of ink as it goes down in a ways that's much more expressive, hands-on, it really suited Bill. So that this print, there are 15 of these prints, and not one of them looks the same, because there's a mixture of water, ink, wax, and an ink would go down, and then Bill would come into the print and rub sections of it out and then print into it again. And sometimes the same image was printed several times in different colors and rubbed away. So you get this more passage of time, a kind of pathos, but also this versatility of graphic elements energized by different colors. There's a print in the series that's all gray blue, for example. And this is actually taken from the starting point of this was a photograph of the wall in the studio. And as I'd mentioned earlier, Bill's studio was as much a kind of gallery museum experience as it was a studio experience. So you got to see the kinds of things that inspired Bill, and those things in turn circled back and were incorporated into the artwork. And so you can see here where the Coca-Cola sign is and the other signage. That was the image from which the print we looked at earlier was taken. So this is one of this photograph is a multiple exposure of a large wall in the Christenberry studio. And then this was used to make the prints you saw earlier, and then a print of the entire wall, which was one of the last big projects that Bill produced before he could no longer work.
Yeah, that's it, I think. Yeah. Well, that's a pretty good explanation, George. Thank you. Someone has asked if Bill ever created a work in any medium that was dedicated to a particular family member. he did make a piece for me that we ended up selling to Gerard Sander because we needed the money. But he incorporated pieces that had been used by family members or maybe made by family members. He had a piece that his grandfather, D.K. Christenberry, in his last years when he was bedridden, he kept a calendar by his bedside. I think it was 1947. And on each page of the, each month of the calendar, he would write in different events that had happened, like the first flower, first blooming tree of spring, or whatever. And in one, you know, he wrote down the death of his son Robert, who had committed suicide. He wrote when Bill was born on November the 5th, 1936, in Tuscaloosa, Druid City Hospital. And so Bill had taken that calendar and framed each piece individually. And he would, then he took his grandfather's cane, one of his canes that his grandfather had carved himself, and a change purse that he had that had some coins in it and a bill of sale for some feed that he'd bought at the feed store, and created this very moving piece. So, and when Bill's father died, he wrote in the date of Paul's death. And in October, let's see, when was it?
2016.
The 2016, yeah. And Mobile, I think, was the exhibition.
The Mobile exhibition.
Yeah. He, Andrew, our son, wrote in the death of his father, Bill Christenberry. So it's a very moving piece that will go to Andrew. You know, he will keep it up, keep it. But in general, he didn't make things for specific people. Can you think of anything, George? Okay.
No, I think that it was...
he did make that dream building that's called Ode to Billie Holiday.
Homage
to Billie Holiday, yeah, the dream building. Uh-huh.
Right, and he also made the sculpture, Strange Fruit.
Right.
Which is a reference to
Billie Holiday. Yeah, that's, it's Strange Fruit, but it's an homage to Billie Holiday. Right.
So, no, but I think, you know, that's different artists are different ways, the vocabulary they develop. And I think that if, I mean, my feeling, nothing against family artwork or that sort of thing, but it would seem outside the university was building. And in a way, it was, I mean, it's going to sound odd, double talk, but in a way, it incorporated the idea about family.
Yeah. Right. And really had people in his photographs.
Yeah. Yeah. It really had people in the photographs. And we are, to a certain extent, the places in which we grow up, in which we live. And that, in that sense, it's about family, because it's about the things that shape us, the objects and the landscape and the buildings that we inhabit. So. But, you know, it would seem, if I'd gone in the studio and Bill said, well, I made this dream building and it's about Sandy, I'd think, well, maybe you lost your mind.
Well, now, he was always very busy, you know. He loved working in the studio. And, of course, his... the later years, you know, as he became sicker and sicker, he stopped making art, period. You know, he wouldn't. At first, I thought that perhaps he realized that he couldn't make his work as he had been doing in the past, and therefore he was not even going to try. But of course, later on, he got where he couldn't make it because he couldn't remember. It was a long, drawn out, sad period. And
It's as we all know, it's a very difficult disease, and it seems to vary from person to person.
Yeah.
My father had Alzheimer's pretty much around the same time and died a little bit before Bill died, and it was striking to me how different it was for each individual.
Yeah, well, that's true. I mean, I had mentioned in my notes, I think, that I was a member of a support group at Iona House Senior Services in Northwest DC, and it was a blessing to me because there were 12 people in the group, not all of whom would be in each meeting, of course, but we got to have so much support for what we're going through, and you could say what you wanted to say and not be, you know, held, not be thought of any of the worse because you were, you know, felt like screaming at your loved one. But anyway, wait, let's say I've got a note here. Yeah. Oh, right. Our daughter Emlyn has reminded me that Bill did make one piece of art for his mother. We called her Nanny. I'm Nanny now. But she wanted a painting to go on the wall above the couch in the den. And she wanted a picture of wildflowers. So Bill, he painted a picture of wildflowers for her. And it's a beautiful painting. We have it. But it's not a typical Christenberry painting. But it really pleased his mother. Are there, do we have times for questions now or what? Yeah. Marissa, do you want to join us now? Okay.
Hi, all. So my name is Marissa Bateman. I work for the DC Public Library, and I'll be answering a few questions that you've added to the chat. So thank you very much for doing that. I have a question from Leah, you mentioned selling a particular piece must be hard sometimes. What factors factor into your decisions to keep certain pieces in the family or to sell them to collectors?
Well, when we were younger, money was a factor because you have to keep things going. So selling a piece of art that you loved was just, you know, something that had to be done. There are some things, however, that you won't part with, like that painting that Bill did for Nanny will be in our family. And the wall piece that Bill made, calendar wall, will be Andrew's. And there are various books and photographs that will be given to the kids, you know, that as well as charitable donations when I get around to that. But it's just how you feel about it. If you love it and you don't want to let it go, you don't let it go. We're fortunate that we got to the point where we could do that. We didn't have to let go.
May I ask, Sandy, are there any favorite pieces that you've held on to that you just that are very personal to you, if you don't mind sharing?
Well, let's see. There's a drawing that Bill made for me when we were dating. It was a very simple pencil drawing of line drawing of roses, red roses, and it was in a silver, a gold plated frame. And I loved that. And we, you know, I had that in the house and took it everywhere with us when we moved. And one time he came to me and he said, I really need that gilt frame for something I'm working on. Can I have it? And I said, well, okay, you can have the frame, but the drawing is mine. And eventually he place the flame too. They're Kate, do you have, you know, mostly the things that we've kept have been works that the kids produced. Bill kept a file for like every child with things in it from pre-K on up. I finally gave them those things a couple of years ago, and I think the first thing they did was to throw them away.
I'm just going to add something as well. Our friend Phil is actually showing a photograph. One second, I'm going to take myself off screen and make him the big one.
Go ahead, Phil.
I'm saving this. This is one of the...
Oh, yeah, that's red truck.
The southern, is it southern? It's a southern, right? Or northern?
Yeah.
Southern.
Right.
Yeah.
The name for it. We love it.
Well, I'm glad you do love it. But, yeah, I think that was, I don't know why he took that. I guess because it had the name Southern on it.
I think the title was Red Trailer.
Oh, really?
Red Trailer. I think it is Red
I don't know all that stuff, so.
So we have another question, Sandy. Can you talk more about Bill's paintings specifically versus his drawings and other work?
Well, Bill went to the University of Alabama for his BFA and then his master's degree. And as George had said earlier, he was very much influenced by abstract expressionism. And so he did make these paintings that were very abstract, very beautiful, but they also had content. I mean, he made paintings of graveyards. He made paintings of tenant houses, not many. And he would take photographs with a little Browning, and then he'd tack these photographs up in the studio to use as references for the paintings that he was making. Then, you know, he stopped making that kind of work. But when he began making the building constructions, the actual buildings, the sculptures of buildings in the actual landscape, he said that that really involved a lot of painting, you know, to make things look rusted and old, weathered. And so he considered that a form of painting still, but not, he never did go back to the really large paintings that he had done before, earlier, like in the 60s. He did make later, I guess this would have been probably late 90s, George, early 2000s, some small paintings using encaustic. That's wax that's been imbued with a color of paint. And he would have a block of wood, like a little frame wood, piece of wood, and he would draw, or he'd make like a green warehouse, or I think there's a red building in Forest, but, and that was about it. Do you have anything, George, to add to that about the painting?
No, but what you're saying about the sculpture and the sculptures that represented actual buildings and creating a faux effect that looked like weathering or staining or rust or whatever.
The signs that would be rusted out. And
well, and the thing too was is the other part of that was is when he began to do Southern monuments, they often had passages, let's say like the side of that cube. That one was all found metal, but he may have the side of a cube where it was completely rubbed with a pigment that would look like soil, for example. And in the wall constructions, there were passages that were different pieces of metal and numbers and pieces of signage, all taken from the Alabama landscape. But there may be a large passage that would just be a wooden surface. And on those wooden surfaces, he typically painted with tempera paint. Tempera paint is temperamental, and it's also fugitive. And so those passages in the paintings had the quality of on their own, kind of having an aging quality over time. And because of their fragility, they often expressed a little bit of the pigment over a period of time. So they would fade a bit, or they would change. Or if they had any kind of handling around the edges, those edges would show wear. And for Bill, that was very close to painting, but it was using the process to create the painterly effect. So it was almost an extension of the faux painting on the representational sculptures, but on the abstract pieces and the wall constructions, it was much more like abstract expressionist painting. And those wall constructions were always abstract. There was never a, right, like, oh, this looks like a tree, or this looks like a house, or they were completely abstract pieces. And I think then the answer to the question is, he didn't paint with a brush typically. He painted with all these different parts, the kind of collage as painting. So
we just have time for probably one or two more questions. I have a question from Linda. She says, tell us about Mr. Dudley's vision of McCone Street as a place for writers and artists to live. Who were some of them?
Oh, well, I believe Cy Hirsch lived in your house, Phil, for a while, not when we lived here. Lou lives on Newark Street. But when we moved here, all the houses on this side of the block, except for the very first one by the alley, were owned by Tilford and Martha Dudley. Tilford was a Democrat. And really they were very marvelous people, but they seemed to be able to find artists, musicians, writers to live in these houses. I don't know how we gravitated here, but like, I know how we got our house was by word of mouth because, Martha Morrison, lived there with her boyfriend and they were splitting up. So I saw her at an opening and she said, well, you know, I'm moving. And it turned out that that was the house that I had already looked at once. So I, you know, it was a lot of fun. Evelyn DeBook was a musician. Her husband, Alex, was a painter and he worked at Dunmartin Oaks for many, many years. You could always tell when Alex was coming home because you could hear him whistling down the street. Whenever you saw him, say, hi, Alex, he'd say, good morning, no matter what time of day it was. Good morning, good morning. It was, Cleveland Park has been such a great neighborhood to live in. We've loved it, all of us.
That's such a nice note about the neighborhood. Thanks for sharing. So just one more question, if you don't mind. So we had a couple questions specifically about Bill's opinion of the Ku Klux Klan, as you mentioned. So I just want to kind of put two questions together first, and we just have a couple minutes. I just want to say, Bill did a lot of pieces or did several pieces about it. Can you say something about how Bill dealt with race in his work? And also there was a comment that one of the pieces, the Dream Buildings, wondering if it was any reference to the Klan with the tall pointed head coverings.
Well, first of all, Bill had created a body of work called the Klan Tableau, which came about because of his abhorrence of the Klan. And he made an environment that consisted of dolls that were dressed in various Klan robes. You know, they're regular Klansmen or the Grand Dragon or whatever they call them. And environments in which they were, a jail or a coffin or... he had all of this body of work, which he worked on for quite a while, you know, off and on, in a separate room from the main body of the studio on Connecticut Avenue, and it was stolen. We're not sure exactly when. It was over the holidays at 1978, 79. And Bill felt that whoever did that must have known his routine, because they knew he was always watching Alabama football over that weekend and all of the, you know, games, and wouldn't be in the studio. So he recreated that body of work. That theft was the cause of the dream that he had about the dream building. The first one, he dreamed that he saw a building that was covered in signs with a very pitched roof, no doors, no windows. And it made such an impression on him that he said he was going to make it, which he did. And so in terms of the dream buildings being a reference to the Klan, I think there is some of that, but it, you know, people also say, well, it looks like the Washington Monument. So I think it's a combination of things, but there, yeah, I think there's definitely a reference to the Klan shape, you know, the Klan hood in those works. But he was not a joiner or a marcher or a protester, except in his own private way of dealing with this body, this Klan work. So that's, George, do you have anything to add?
No, I think that, you know, we've seen artists throughout time depict evil. And it's a little more difficult in our time with something like the Ku Klux Klan, because in order to give veracity to that depiction of evil, you have to kind of represent the evil. And so the Klan work has always had an ability to spark opinion. And sometimes that opinion has been severe and unfair to Bill's actual position about race, racism, and the existence of the Ku Klux Klan, which is clearly one of the worst things this country's ever produced. I mean, you know, it's the legacy of the national sin of slavery.
Yeah.
So it's there as a body of work. And I think as with all difficult subject matter and artwork, as time passes and the society solves or begins to solve those problems of race and racism, the subject matter becomes easier to digest. But there's an experience that we have when we actually look at that material that's somewhat scolding of us. And some people's reaction is to be defensive, and other people's reaction is constructive. So I think that it's an important body of work, but it's a body of work that's often difficult to show. Anytime we put the Klan material into a museum setting, and I was working with Bill, we tried to arrange a day or a morning before the show opened that Bill could talk about the show, including Klan material, with the museum staff. And this meant everybody, top to bottom in the museum. It wasn't one part of the staff. It was, they were all invited.
Everybody. Yeah.
So the idea was that, and this is kind of, at least for me, a nice thing to end on. Once Bill was standing in front of them, whoever it was, museum director, guard, secretary, docent, preparator, whoever it was in the museum, once Bill began to talk about it, his sense of fidelity to a higher goal and his sense of generosity of spirit eradicated any feeling that there was something aberrant about the Klan material. It was the grace of his personality that answered the question. We should all be so lucky.
Thank you, George. Someone asked me if I thought that the Klan tableau was still relevant today. And I said, are you kidding? It's more relevant today than it has been in many, many years. Look what's going on.
I think that's a good place to end. Thank you so much, Sandy and George. It was such a pleasure to have you. I'm going to bring Phil on the screen and he's going to wrap it up. And I hope everyone has a great evening.
Thanks, Marissa.
Thanks, George.
Sandy and George, thank you. That was not just informative, it was delightful. Thanks so much for making yourselves available and giving up your time tonight. Thank you. And I want to thank our audience as well. Now on to the next talk. We hope you will join us again on October 20th. I assume that's a Tuesday, right? Tuesday talks. For All It's Happening. It's called All It's Happening at the Zoo. And the National Zoo Animal Keepers, Catherine Giuliano and Amanda Bubiak will discuss topics ranging from conservation breeding to the social dynamics and cognitive abilities of elephants. And it's a change in direction, but it will be fascinating. Join us. Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right.